Greetings everybody, I am Shujaat from Medicos Lectures by Shujaat, and today we are going to talk about hypercortisolism. In particular, we are going in its pathology and endocrinology. So whenever we are going to talk about pathology, we have to start from very basic, that from where it starts. So on kidneys, we have adrenal gland. When we saw its cross section, it is divided into adrenal cortex and adrenal medulla. Further, adrenal cortex is divided into three parts, zona glomerulosa, zona fasciculata, and zona reticularis. On zona fasciculata, we have a secretion of aldosterone, which further leads us to the hyperadrenalism. So whenever we are going to talk about hypercortisolism, it is basically an excess of cortisol level in our body. And in its reverse terminology or in its synonym terminology, which says that we have a Cushing syndrome or Cushing disease, which basically means that excess of cortisol in our body. And this Cushing syndrome is further divided into two, means exogenous and endogenous. Whenever we're going to talk about exogenous, so it's basically means that from outside, from outsource, we have this. It is basically IV steroids or drug abuser usage will be cause of this. No talking about the endogenous type of Cushing syndrome. So as its name shows, endogenous means there is nothing from outside which is going to be involved. There is an inside mechanism that is going to be affected and causing an hyper secretion of cortisol level. So first of all, whenever going to talk about endogenous factor or endogenous type, we have to discuss the mechanism of secretion of cortisol. So the process is very simple, that on hypothalamus we have a releasing of cortical releasing hormone, and this cortical releasing hormone will go to the anterior pituitary, and then on anterior pituitary it releases ACTH, adrenocorticotropic hormone, and then this adrenocorticotropic hormone will come to the adrenal cortex and stimulate that adrenal cortex and release cortisol hormone. So it's a very simple mechanism of secretion of cortisol hormone. Now talking about that, how abnormality develops. So if tumor develops on this region, means on hypothalamus. So if there is an abnormality on hypothalamus, so this will ultimately lead us to the hyperplasia. Means it starts its secretion more and more, so it leads us to the hyperplasia. In the same way, if we have a tumor on anterior pituitary, so it will lead us to the adenoma on anterior pituitary, and the secretions of cortisol level further will increase. And we have two main types, mean if we have primary adrenal neoplasm or PHPD. Talking about the lab investigations for detecting the hypercortisolism and Cushing syndrome, so they are basically 24-hour urinary cortisol test, means we have to check the level of cortisol all around course of the day. If its level is in between 50 to 100 milligram, so we have a patient with Cushing syndrome. So that's basically depicting the cortisol level in a urine. We have a second test, which is low dexamethasone suppression test. At 11 p.m. we have to give 1 mg dexamethasone, and we have to check the reaction of adrenal gland in response to that. So normally the patient without Cushing syndrome or without hypercortisolism have low level of response in morning, while the patient with possessing Cushing syndrome and hypercortisolism have an elevated level of adrenal gland response in morning. Late night salivary test is basically used to check the amount of adrenal gland and cortisol in that saliva. In the same way, high dose dexamethasone, we have to give almost 8 mg dexamethasone at 11 p.m. So we have to check the reaction of adrenal gland. So in the same way, in normal patient it is low, and in hypercortisol patient it is an elevated level of adrenal gland. Now talking about the morphology, that what are the structural changes that are going to be involved in it. So as we talk about the tumors, so if tumor is in adrenal gland, so it will cause the secretion of adrenal gland increase, means cortisol level increase. But in the same way, in reverse of that increase in cortisol level, we have a decrease in pituitary gland. In the same way, if the secretion is more and tumor is on pituitary gland, there is an hyperplasia in that, and we have apparent change in the cells of the pituitary gland. In the same way, we have an increase in secretion of that ACTH. So if ACTH cells apparently change, so we have the syndrome which says that we have a change from the name Krug-Hylian change. What are the clinical features? So clinical features are increased weight, means there is a more fat production starts. Buffalo hump means there is a more fat production around your cheeks, and swallowing start, and accumulation of fat around neck means more fat around neck will be accumulated. Cutaneous striae mean changes in skin color and skin texture will be start. In the same way, osteoporosis will be start. And look, now I would like to talk about the disease and syndrome difference. Cushing syndrome means there is an complete pathway which is going to be involved, mean hypothalamus, pituitary gland, in the same way adrenal also involved. But Cushing disease means that either hypothalamus or pituitary has defect, or either adrenal cortex or pituitary has an effect, means not complete process is going to be involved, only a few part of that process is affecting. So that we says that it is an pituitary disease, or it is a Cushing disease. Treatment are basically surgery, radiation, chemotherapy in case of tumors, and cortisol inhibiting drug to suppress that level of cortisol, to spread that elevated level of cortisol in body. So guys, this is our basic lecture on hypercortisolism, from its very basic to its deep pathology. Hope you all will get it. Don't forget to subscribe to Medicos lectures by Shujaat. Thank you so much.